lane. In bot lane, Zygzyra versus Karma and Ashe. To me, it seems like the jungle's going to try and swing that one the most because the other lane's pretty predictable in terms of playstyle.
Yeah. Be interesting to see Sohan coming through on the Jace. Has played a couple carry-style tops in the Kespa Cup. Rumble and Cannon both in that mix. Makes sense for the Cannon ban coming through from the side of Kongdu Monster. But the Malzahar for Kuzan, something he's only played, I believe, twice so far this split. Played it against BBQ and against Longju.
Has good lane control over the Ryze, also level 6. Lee Sin ult and the Malzahar ult might be enough to take down the Ryze. Pushing is guaranteed in the Jace, and to some degree, the Malzahar lanes. The big question is bot lane, though. We've seen these Ziggs comps have their way, take 4-minute turrets, and we've also seen them really struggle if there's any early jungle attention. So I'm going to be watching specifically the pathing from Punch. Very consistent pathing on the Graves, but the other champions leave a bit more to be desired. So let's see if you can generalize that playstyle onto the Rek'Sai this timeout.
Yep, I want to see if Sohan's going to bring out the Smet build on the Jace. Go for that Lord Dominic's regard, but let's go ahead and get onto the Rift, see if Kongdu can close this out with a 2-0. All right, here we go. Loaded up nice and early so we can catch any hijinks were they to occur, but seems like we're going to have a much more standard start from both teams. No one going for the gank brush.
Teddy representing the Oceanic Release skin was, in fact, Pool Party Ziggs given out to all Oceanic players. As we have everyone here. More Jhin Air fans than Kongdu fans, predictably, especially in League of Legends. Pretty good crowd here, about 250, 300 fans, which for, you know, two struggling orgs.
Wednesday at 5 p.m.
True.
Well, not 6 p.m., but, you know.
Hard to expect to sell out for two of the lower placed teams. Punch with that Keystone. When you see Fervor, you know to expect that plenty of aggression is going to be planned by this Rek'Sai.
Yeah, speaking of which, Jhin Air aggressing forward into the jungle of Kongdu. And looks like we'll just have a trade of the red buffs coming through.
The most Thunderlords, predictably, when you see the Ziggs bottom, it's 4-5.
The ward expired from Roach, so we'll see which path Sohan takes. They won't get spotted as he goes back up towards the top lane, but you have to expect that Kongdu has an idea that this is going on.
Invested a lot also. Control ward was placed in the jungle. Trying to work out where that came from now that I think about it. But it looks like it was from Snowflower, who started with a potion less. Doran's Blade start is really interesting from Sol. He's against a poke support, but you're kind of serving multiple masters when you're against Zygzyra. The theory behind Longsword and also the boots was that against poke lanes you need to stay up, but you need health against the all-ins that Zyra and Ziggs can put out as early as level 3, but certainly at level 6 we often see a lot of kill pressure from those Ziggs lanes.
Punch is taking out these Krux. He's going low, and Monty's wrapping around from below. Flashes over the wall. Here comes the Lee Sin. Spots him out. Can he make it out of here alive? Guguru with the wraparound will offer him up a shield, but that's going to be the Sonic Wave with a Resonating Strike going forward. Umti trying to come
anything
with
else?
The kill. Flash forward. Snowflower, he's able to find the first blood as he takes out the Rek'Sai. Guguru going low, trying to kite back as best he can, but Sol, he flashes
got
forward.
It. Double
buff. The
kill.
The double buff now over onto the Ash. Going to be looking for Snowflower, who has no flash to get out of here. Slowing up with the red with those frost arrows, but still will not be able to kill that Zyra. They'll trade one for one. First blood still goes over to Jhin Air.
I don't think we've ever had three buffs in the bot lane at 3 minutes, but double buffs for Sol and red buff on Snowflower is just an insane start. To really spice things up in the bot, Teddy will be watching over to Sol, who can't really make the best use of blue buff early because it's such a high flat cooldown on the volley in early levels. His kingdom for a blue buff is basically where he's at right now.
Oh, well, a bit of a rocky start here for both sides. It's gonna give a slight little lead over to Jhin Air.
And the invade was really greedy from Punch. Sure, it's take the enemy red buff, but taking specifically the Krugs, such a slow camp to clear, basically in the front of the eyes of the enemy duo lane, was an unnecessary risk. He wasn't level 4 Graves yet, so that's why perhaps he was not used to that scenario.
No Tiamat.
Yeah.
So, does slow you down considerably, so Punch does pay for that in Vayne. But the trade back onto the double buffs here for Soul, it's going to be still quite nice for him. Now MT doing something that Punch did to him very much so in that first game, but won't be able to get the big Raptor in the end.
MT has been favoring the Lee Sin. Lee Sin mechanics have been good, but translate that into game victories, few and far between for Jhin Air and Lee Sin, and for the LCK in general, although it has picked up a bit more recently. It's not the death sentence that it once was.
It was a very rocky start, though. Now we go back to this Poppy in the top lane for Roach.
Really like the first purchase, though, as I digress from top lane, because I don't really want to talk about Poppy first. I want to talk about Berserk Agrees as the rush from Seoul.
Oh, yeah.
Hmm. Boots start, as I mentioned, was starting to become a thing, but rushing boots, too. You know, there's two ways to go against something like the Zigzyra. You will remember Ruler having no itemization choices on the Caitlyn against this lane, not being able to buy a Hex Drinker for fear of falling too far behind in terms of itemization, just dying all the time. Rushing boots too, more likely to be able to step away from the Grasping Roots. No CC's hit, then the burst damage less likely to hit, as I think happens in top.
Bit of trade damage back to the air from Soan, doesn't take anything, and a Shock Blast connects, so he chunks out Punch, so keeping himself safe, but that's going to be the flash burned out from him.
You have all the early purchases to deal with this lane. Short of a Hex Drinker, Boots 2, I think, is the best one, so I do like that pickup from Soul. We'll get Essence Reaver Hurricane at some point, no need to have them early in the laning phase.
Yeah, and it's a good adaptation. I mean, he's going to be relatively safe as far as the items goes as the tier comes through from Teddy. Moves on. Good deny on the back.
You still have to hit the same timings on Ashe compared to someone like Caitlyn. Essence Reaver by itself isn't much of a spike. It's all about the two items, and that will come pretty much on time. In bot lane.
Yeah, Gugger goes in with a tether. Snowflower gonna get exhausted.
No flash.
Good amount of damage. Here comes Punch. Has no flash available, but still is able to snipe it out with the Prey Seeker to come up with an answering kill in the bottom lane. So Kongdu will go 2-1, still slightly down in gold as that CS discrepancy in top is opening things up for Jhin Air, but good rotation down to the bottom lane.
The thing about Zigzyra, you know, it looked so oppressive when we saw it early in the split, certainly in solo queue.
So damn squishy.
It can run away with the game. That's one thing. The squishiness is certainly there, but the squishiness is more apparent, Achilleos, because it can only really push. It can't really control the wave. Last hitting when you don't have short fuse up is actually super difficult to do as Ziggs because of your low base AD. If you queue a minion wave, then you push it, and then the squishiness becomes relevant. You come in, you collapse. Nice pathing from Punch to get him while Flash was down.
Oh, yeah. Roach started rotating down. Sonic Wave connects, but MT not level 6, can't go in with the Resonating Strike, trying to get that Dragon's Rage off, so just goes ahead and peels back, but still a good amount of pressure applied onto the Poppy. Recall's coming through yet again, no TP, so she's going to have to mosey her way on back towards that turret.
Looking at the schedule for Kongdu, who will of course be traveling over to IAM Katowice at the end of the week. Match against Jhin Air today, and their last match will be against KT Rolster later this week. That'll be their last match before they head off. That one's certainly penciled in for a loss, but picking up a match victory before they go international will be a big boon for this organization. They had today circled, and things like returning to bot while that flash was down shows they still do have good shot calling. They still can play some ordered League of Legends. Still a lot to do here behind in gold at 8 minutes, but already the best series of play so far from Kongdu that they had so far this season.
Yeah, for sure, and that's exactly what they need. I mean, at the moment, having that negative 10 score line, they're 4 points behind ROX Tigers. So we need 2-2-0 wins to really even try to even out the score and get themselves out of that 10th place spot.
And that's definitely a second round robin thing. The first round robin, will they go in last? Almost certainly. But second round robin, we've seen teams like Afrika go 7-2 and push their way up. Admittedly from slightly less depths in this current lineup of Kongdu, but hey, go 7-2 and you're certainly very comfortably staying in the LCK for summer.
A bit more questionable here for Kongdu. As at the end of things, they might find themselves facing off against CJ Entis.
I mean, all they can do is realize the past is the past. They'll be frustrated about some of their losses so far this season, but all they can do is start to find match victories, find confidence that certainly was not there for this team who did roll over and die for a couple of best of threes in a row that we cast Killios. And you're right, CJ Entis certainly in the challenges have been burning up the charts. You look at their roster, they have players that, you know, I'm pretty disappointed aren't playing in the LCK. Winged, especially from the jungle, is better to me than a challenger jungler.
I mean, Veritas, as we were talking about Unicorns earlier on, came back to Korea to play for that squad.
Pure in the support role also. Very adequate support, so their lineup is better than challenger.
Oh, flash forward here from Roach. Setkeeper's verdict here onto Sohan. Flash forward again by Ponch. They're investing a lot to get this kill onto the Jace, but
they have the damage.
Yeah,
he's got like
that Excel Gate to get himself back behind the turret.
He's
roaming
empty.
His way up. Don't think he's going to have the damage to take anybody out. The Sonic Wave won't connect anyway, but a big investment from Roach and Punch, and they can't come up with a kill onto a Jace who didn't even have Flash.
Yeah, and that's the thing, is their Flash is down. Itemization points not really there for Roach. Usually when you get the Ninja Tabi, that's when the lane starts to really go towards Poppy, who probably will have it on next back. 20 CS down, although we'll push in this lane and get a bit more closer to 15 CS. Lane going as expected for Poppy. We saw it so many times at Worlds in the Kasper Cup. Poppy eventually does get control of Jace. Unless Jace can really hit his item timings accelerated, and given that he's 0-0-0 at 10 minutes, probably not going to be an accelerated item build for this Jace.
Yeah. He's farming well as he's about to breach 100 CS at about 11 minutes. Has that Phage ready to go.
It's funny how item timings will be very relevant this game. Just talking about Poppy. Mid lane, item timing's delayed for Ryze. We'll be going for QSS before Catalyst and even the Rod of Ages. Big story there is that we talked about the potential lockup of Malzahar into Lee Sin. No reaction possible. Speaking of reactions.
Yep, up top, they come flash forward from Kuzan. Gets that Nethergrass coming through, and Roach just nothing else he can do. He gets made quick work of, and he will go down. A second kill put on the board here for Jhin Air. Can they convert this into a turret? Looks like the answer will be yes. Meanwhile, Kongdu Monster will be trading that first brick gold for an Infernal Drake.
So easy to roam on Ryze, even if he'd gone Catalyst, no ability power yet in the build. Certainly no Jace when it comes to turret taking, so we'll only get a modicum of damage into the mid lane turret. Ryze will roam over. They do claim the Infernal Drake. Do they want more? The answer seems no, because there was, in fact, a control ward to spot out the Ryze.
Mega Infernal Bomb, not going to come up with a steal. So Kongdu will just be trading objectives, so for now that's going to put them at a pretty significant deficit. Just almost 2,000 gold down now at this point.
Big item timing for Jace. Straight up Black Cleaver with double Doran Blade, and Jace actually in the bot side jungle. Accelerating the game is exactly what Jhin Air wants. Infernal Drake, Scaling Drake. The Ryze and Poppy will outscale their opponents as well. We already saw a very nice accelerated game played by Kongdu Monster in game one. You knew it from the Ziggs, the time that Ziggs was drafted. Same style would suit Jhin Air, but Sohan doesn't find anything for his time this time.
Yeah. Teddy, though, you know, not really able to utilize that Ziggs, get him into a position where he can start knocking down those turrets. So first brick just comes out of the top jungle and mid laners of Jhin Air.
It was probably a response to the QSS being completed. Suddenly you can't play through the Malzahar lane because Ryze had double summoner and the answer to the Nether Grasp. So good roam, good timing. No way for Kongdu to punish it with a turret take at least. Now we do see Umpty trying to play around mid lane as much as possible despite the QSS there from the Ryze.
Shoves forward, finds that control ward. Clear that out.
More turret damage.
A lot of turret damage coming through. Punch is roaming his way over, but Edge is right behind him, so he'll hand off these minions. Arrives in time to go ahead and pick up the cannon. Blue buff still a little ways off, so Jhin Air won't be able to stick around and try to take that one away from Edge. So that'll help him just keep up the wave clear, stack up that tier even faster, because he needs to get to a catalyst pretty soon. You can see he already has the makings of that coming through.
Yeah, item timings and scaling definitely works for Kongdu. The only champions that outscale on the side of Janair, you could argue that Lee Sin outscales Rek'Sai specifically because the kick is something that really is difficult to itemize or counterplay against in the late game. And Zyra probably outscales Karma a little bit, but certainly not in a sheer way. Every other champion confidently outscales from Kongdu, so keep up the speed. That's why it's good to see someone in mid to get the turret low.
Oh, Ash Air thrown out from bottom lane. Won't come up with a connection, though. So on will be safe, but they do get a lot of damage in onto that turret. Also, a bit of a close call on that blue buff. Ooh, Guger comes up with the Scuttle Crab. Nicely done with that Mantra Q. Take that one away.
They are forcing Roach to come mid lane. Wants to pick up some CS. Close the gap, but... game being accelerated.
There you have it.
Yep, very nice. From the Ziggs. With the Satchel Charge.
Yep, just can't punish him for walking up quickly enough, so he's able to toss out the W.
So far, so good from Janair. They've certainly made some mistakes, but at least they have two charts for show. This is exactly how they need to play the early game. Now let's see if they can complete the setup and take the bottom out of turret as well.
That blue buff went over to MT.
That's not ideal.
I guess maybe the red buff taking that one away, because the only thing that was nearby otherwise was
the Voidlings
from Kuzan, so I guess red buff had ticked it down.
When you support Malzahar, you can certainly steal buffs with the Voidlings at level 1, so...
that's tilt-worthy.
Does happen more often than you'd expect.
Or maybe not tilt-worthy, it's a very big annoyance.
Malzahar, a very big annoyance.
Yep. My solo queue agrees.
How are your solo queue adventures going these days, Kilius?
I haven't been playing too much lately. You know, just been having fun. Relaxing with some other games, lost my most recent series, but otherwise, decently okay. Climbing has been easier the last couple times that I've played.
Some fruitful climbs. We always wish you the best on those climbs. My climbs are up and down.
I'll make gold one day.
Golden KR, huh?
Yeah, the dream. I can play in the LCS now.
I don't know if they have exchange rates between gold and the Diamond 3 requirement for LCS.
It's close enough, right? I just sit back and I let the rest of my teammates carry me. I could be on Echo Fox.
Hey.
I'm kidding. They've been doing really well, Cadian. Putting in the work as of late. We have promising jungle talent here in Korea as well as North America, what with contracts and Acadian coming out.
It's definitely a jungle renaissance. It was always something that was bemoaned was NA jungle talent. And then Dardock came through and everyone was like, all right. Something to be excited about. And then, as you say, a bounty in North America and Korea of young jungle talent.
Been a rather good time for them. Still waiting for those star ADCs to pop up. But there's still potential for a lot of these new ones that have come out. Cody Sun on the side of Immortals.
P word. The potential word's always a risky one to throw out.
I think it's a safe word.
I didn't ask for a safe word, Achilles.
All right. Well, Cody Sun is not my safe word. OMT gets popped up, takes a lot of damage, and neither is potential. Punch goes low. They'll back out. Make Inferno Bomb comes out. Soul takes a big burst of damage. Flash forward onto the Nether Grasp, and they will erase that Ash. Janair coming up with yet another kill. This game looking much better for them. And you can see Sohan just has so much pressure on the Poppy up in that top lane, whittling away at that tier 2 turret, and Punch just hasn't been in a position to roam up there to counteract.
Yeah, when they have to rotate second because of a draft, Kongdu always look a bit more questionable. Trying to turn on Teddy.
Yeah, Realm Warp comes through, Rutsu lock up Punch, and you can see they take quite a bit of damage still. Good minefield thrown down by Teddy to slow them up. Force them to push through that damage. It's going to be an Ocean Drake picked up by Janair. If not, the tier 2 on top of it. And so on just continues to wail away on it. Another Infernal Drake will be following up.
Now wait for Edge to flash forward there into a lack of vision and most likely an oncoming Lee Sin. Meant no snare and thus no kill onto the Ziggs. Janair continue to play to their draft. Need to play ordered League of Legends, and Kongdu just looking for time. Rod of Age is only now completed, about 5 to 6 minutes later than the average par time, means that 28, 29 minutes before that's fully stacked.
Yep. So know, Kongdu going to be looking to play the Jhin Air side of things and stretch this game out as long as possible. But for now, Jhin Air, they have the heat turned up quite adequately.
And Jhin Air in game one against MVP actually were able to really accelerate a game. Wasn't quite the Ziggs draft, but it was very similar. Way ahead, took an early bound and finished the game at 28 minutes in the most un-Jhin Air-like thing I've ever seen, so they'll be looking to recreate that here. But there's no way for Kongdu to dictate anything. They haven't been able to put down any deep vision. In fact, they don't have good defensive coverage either. They really need to get down control wards around their jungle camps. As you can see, Ash mousing over one of the control wards. They need a line of control wards to have a line of scrimmage to defend, because if they walk out to the river, plenty of ways to be picked by Malzahar, Lee Sin, and Zyra in particular. Hard to defend vision as well, and that means that Jhin Air continues to push it up, and there's just very safe, few safe places for Kongdu to farm.
We'll have to see when Seoul wants to opt into that QSS. As for now, we'll be building up towards that Hurricane, so you can probably expect it to come in as a third item, or a 2.5 item, I guess.
I mean, the Hurricane gives that 30% CDR with the Essence Reaver and the Utility Core. And then from there, you're kind of free to go wherever you want. Infinity Edge if you're snowballing, and something like a Mercurial Scimitar, which desperately needed for Seoul.
Roach,
things are going a bit better.
Trying to defend this one. Sticking on top of Seoul, I'll take a couple turret shots, but still has a lot of damage to trade back. What with that last Whisper in the Black Cleaver? So, all things considered, comes out pretty even and gets that Keeper's Verdict away from Roach.
Got an Iceborn Gauntlet short of actually being able to take down the Jace. And will he actually have the liberty to build Iceborn Gauntlet against Ziggs from the bot lane? Probably no.
I mean, there's 3 AP damage sources on the side of Jhin Air, and then 2 very strong ADs here in the Lee Sin and the Jace. So Roach is in a bit of a pickle when it comes down to his itemization.
I guess the one thing you could say is that he's going to spend a lot of the game matching Jace.
Trying to.
Couldn't really fault him for going for a lane-focused build, which would be picking up something like the Iceborn Gauntlet. Then he shows up in the team fight.
Oh.
We'll get exploded by things like that Mega Infernal Bomb.
You can see Seoul not even caught in the inner circle of that, still takes about 30% of his HP and damage. Fon just clearing out that ward over Baron, takes a little bit of damage in the answer as the Tiamat triggers him. But so on. Surprisingly, looking very good on this Jace, who weren't sure how he was going to manage.
I think surprisingly, given his reputation as a solo queue aggressive laning focused player like Riven, I wouldn't say I'm surprised about the Jace. I just think the setups and kind of how safe he's been with his aggression. You know, we saw someone like Huni who struggled to make the Jace work against Afrika and ended up being too safe and not aggressive enough. Feels like Seoul has drawn the right balance in this game and got more objectives as a result. Things are a bit quiet now.
They are 4.7 thousand gold in the lead is Jhin Air. 3 turrets to 0. The only thing Kongdu really has going for them at this point is that Infernal Drake that they're able to pick up at the start of the game. There is a second one spawning in about 1.5 minutes.
Yes,
could be a very big pickup for them if they're able to find it, because as you go into the late game again, the scaling on that rise is going to be immense, as well as the Ash.
CS value is also pretty good, apart from predictably the Poppy still struggling in bot lane. Starting to play around the Infernal Drake, as you say, want to pick that up. Look like they're just going to give up the inner turret. Could be exploded at any point. But that does mean that Jace can't really walk up to the Poppy for now. Kind of knew that Rek'Sai was playing around that side of the jungle.
He's going to start roaming his way back down here, so good to see Punch come in, try to net themselves a kill. Roach got the turret down to about 1/2. Punch comes over the wall edge, looking for maybe the Realm Warp in. Here it comes, so on. Gonna flash away, won't be able to get that on Burrow. Edge still ghosting forward. He's able to get the Rune Prison. Should have the damage to go ahead and take him out. There we go. The wall stun from Roach really sealing the deal on it. But now Oopsie arrives with the big kick onto Edge straight into the Nethergrass. He's going to get cleansed out of that one with the QSS, but gets popped up by the Strangledorns in the end. And now the arrival from the rest of the members of Jhin Air will be able to clean house as they take out Kongdu Monster. Oopsie not going to go down in the end. Gets the W back up to pick up the double kill. That's a 3-for-1 in favor of Jhin Air. And hope starting to look lost for Kongdu Monster here in Game 2.
Really sick kick coming out of Umti at the start. A punch, doesn't get the knock-up and then unburrows, so actually he's providing nothing, just walking to melee range as the Rek'Sai. Sure, they take him down, but the big hero here is Umti. Already had Deadman's Plate for the mobility. Knocked up the Ryze, good target selection. Sure, they eject the Malzahar, but the damage has been done. Nice cleanup from the bot lane as well. About as good a turn as you could ask for from Jhin Air, and it was, you know, fine for Jace. Jace in general played very respectful until his team was on the right side of the map, and even though he gave up his life, the resulting trade for Jhin Air was ideal.
And just look at all the objectives that they are just collecting right now. The Infernal Drake going to go over to them, so the matching Kongdu in that regard, there's going to be a third one spawning that could be second for either team that's able to snatch it up, but they got the tier 2 in top, they got the tier 2 in mid.
Thought about it.
Yeah, this would be insanely risky by Kongdu. Don't think they can really commit to this objective. Soul turns out the Ash Arrow, does find Sohan, but he takes no damage. Meanwhile, Guger goes low, the plant's just ripping right through him. Mega Inferno Bomb comes up with the kill. Teddy showing off his accuracy with these so far. Picks up yet another one. And now Jhin Air, do they want to just go ahead and try to hound down these members of Kongdu, or do they themselves want to turn onto the Baron?
They don't really have too many other initiation options, barring another insane kick from Umti, so they back away, as you say. They could turn on to Baron. Because Umti's gone, pretty damage focus, only really the dead man's plate for tanking is on the entire team. Would have to be a group effort tanking Baron, and Ryze and Ashe could potentially clean that up. So probably smart to back away for now. Two picks and a Baron, but just the one is probably not enough.
Things really unraveling now here for Kongdu. Down over 7,000 gold. Jhin Air have just kept up the pressure. And I mean, that big sweep, going, you know, able to go from the tier 2 and top, take that one out, rotate all the way down to the bottom, pick up 3 kills into mid, into Dragon. It's just been looking really good for Jhin Air so far here in Game 2, something that was severely lacking in Game 1, but mostly due to Umti having such a better game.
Yeah, as you can say, Umti struggled a bit in the MVP series, struggled extensively in Game 1, but with the Graves banned away, Punch can't get that same playmaking on the Rek'Sai, even though he has 100% kill participation himself. And Jhin Air have really started this draft well, and now they're turning on to Baron.
Yep, Cougar comes around, throws that control ward in. They're going to go ahead and force the TP, so Jhin Air could be happy with that pickup. Do they disengage? Looks like the answer will be yes. They'll just take a little bit of damage on the back end, so they'll still maintain vision control for the most part inside the pit. But now, where do they want to pressure up? Bot turret not really in a great spot. Mid tier 2 already taken. Breaking the inhibitor would still be a bit difficult for them.
If Jhin Air was able to draw out the teleport from Roach but keep Jace's teleport, this would have been a lot more options for them. Now the game is a bit narrower because it was the trade of teleports.
Yeah, could see things stagnate from here and really start shifting back into the Jhin Air mode. They've been pressing their advantages quite well in these last few minutes, so maybe they realize, you know what, we've been doing really well, we've been keeping up the pressure, let's go ahead and take a step back and really drag this one out.
Well, I think that kind of has to be the way, though, Achilles. I know it's a meme that Jhin Air really have to pull out games. They like to play in the super late game. It's just every objective for Jhin Air is free before inhibitor turrets, because when you get to inhibitor turret, you start to funnel up. If Poppy gets a 3-man ultimate, it doesn't matter how many damage items are put together. They're very squishy members of Jhin Air. And Ryze and Ash's item builds are starting to hit high gear.
Yeah, Seraphs has been completed here from Edge as he stacks up.
Ward of Ages will come through before 29 minutes, as we noted at 18 minutes. So the item builds are starting to come together. If they're poking on an outer turret and can threaten to dive, sure. But they cannot dive an inhibitor turret with this lineup, barring the most insane of all kicks from Umti. So this could be where the game does stalemate, unless Jhin Air can get a play around Baron to find a way to close the game.
Interestingly, Sol, I believe he's had that Null Magic Mantle for a while, but opted to go for a BF Sword, wants to get more damage in for these extended skirmishes rather than prioritizing the QSS. That does make him susceptible to those Nether Grasps for quite some time. Haven't seen how much cash he's got in the bank at the moment, so could be a ways away from having that very crucial item completed. Vision Wars in full effect around this Baron pit. They're going to have to shift their attention more than likely, though, rather soon, as the minute 45, that third Infernal Drake will be spawning. Final Drake of the game before we see the Elder poke his head out on the rift.
Pretty free objective, it seems, for Jhenair. Hongdu can only put all their resources in defending one of Baron and Dragon, and even though it's Infernal, Baron will always win that war. Yeah, the easy objectives are gone. Only the inner and bot, but no point playing around that. So for now, game stalls out. Hongdu's build start to get there. They can find themselves less than an item behind their opponents. They have initiation on both range and a flank teleport from the Poppy. So all is not lost yet for Hongdu, even though so far so good from Jhenair Greenwings.
Yeah. And I like that. You can see Kuzan was actually fishing up towards the backside of the pit, waiting for Guger to wrap around and try to clear this vision so he can just hit him with another grasp. He's feeling safe, he's gonna walk forward. Oh, he gets the ward in time. Kuzan not able to lock him down with the ultimate, which would have certainly led to a kill onto the Karma.
It's a really good control ward spot just because a ranged auto attacker can't take it from outside the pit. Only a Caitlyn, for example, at that range. Will be cleared, but it's more and more time for Poppy to trade farm with Jace, the game to slow down. This suits Hongdu.
I was gonna say you could get it with a rapid fire cannon, but the ward would just regain its health before you get your charges back
good
up.
Point. No bursting down wards. Only Shyvana can do that, I believe, with the Q.
Dragon 5 seconds out, though. Still zero vision for either team. We can see Jhenair will have the upper hand. The ping's already coming out. They're going to start roaming down that way.
Triple QSS now, so suddenly more and more people can look to put down control wards. They haven't got any setup. Setup around Baron has been perfect, but the cost is any hope of taking down the Infernal Drake.
So now not only is that double Infernal Drake, but that's triple Dragon here for Jhenair for when that Elder spawns. So that'll definitely be a very juicy target for them. That's when you start, you know, having to wonder, you know, should we go for the Baron? Should we trade that for the Elder Dragon? Or should we just go ahead, pick that up and give the Elder over to Hongdu? Because it wouldn't profit them that much. Give them 12% increase on the stats.
Hongdu being very respectful. Pushing a minion wave, but don't have any vision to be able to walk up even onto the outer top lane turret.
And even if they tried to take it, they'd just be a Mega Infernal Bomb out from Teddy.
Well, it's one of those things where it's like, at best, I'm getting two autos and an Infernal Bomb, or just killed from a gank that I couldn't spot out. So you do the math there, and smart just to back away.
Lose-lose scenario. For the most part, Soul, you can see them, they're waiting, just trying to see if somebody wants to come shove this wave, but Jhenair, they want to focus their attention down around mid. Even after spotting all of them, it's just going to be Soul backing off yet again, just trying to keep the waves crashing in, let the minions do the work, take down the turret.
You remember the siege comp that KT ran that I've referenced a couple of times. The big difference between that comp and this comp is this is a burst comp. They don't have Azir for consistent damage. Sure, you could argue Hyper or the W, the hyperdrive from Jace, something similar, but it's certainly not Azir in the big range on the Sand Soldiers. So that's why Guardian Angels are being purchased here. Big item, will negate burst. Siege is oppressive, but as you can see, they can't walk up and auto attack the turret just yet.
Yep. Roach, though, still getting whittled down. Snowflower with his plants doing quite a bit of work there onto that Poppy.
No real teleport ward means not an angle for the Poppy to punish just yet. Realm Warp would help,
yeah,
though.
Realm Warp's
here we
come
go.
Through. He gets locked up by the Ash Arrow. He's going to flash away immediately. If he can stop midair by Roach, goes in with the stun, locks up Kuzan. He's going low, but they still can't finalize the kill. Edge not able to get into auto attack range, and the Malzahar will live to tell another tale. See Hongdu still getting chunked out. Several members going low. They will have to peel back. Roach gets hit by that Sonic Wave. Umti does not want to go in with the Resonating Strike. Big Shock Blast onto Soul and Punch. That they're going to have to peel back. One bouncing bomb from Teddy would kill the Ash. They have to peel back, so big engagement from Kongdu, but they're still unable to come up with a kill.
But still, it's so close with 7,000 gold disadvantage, Achilleos, and that lets you know that taking that turret will prove frustrating for Jin Air. Their setups around Elder Dragon and Baron are what are going to win this game. Lucky thing for them is because they have a couple of three dragon stacks, Elder Dragon is almost as much of a must-contest objective as Baron is, so having multiple places to fight around the map is so important. If you only have one, then red side, especially for the Baron, can just stall over the wall, can't take the Baron. But red side will be considerably out of position for an Elder Dragon take. It might just have to be a free objective given over to the Jin Air Green Wings. So having those stacks do give a backup win condition, which is desperately needed for Jin Air.
Yep. And you can see there, about 34 minutes, first tower finally going down in favor of Kongdu Monsters. The minions knock down that tier one bot. Top still going to prove elusive. Zahn pushing in for some vision control. Takes a little bit of damage from the Baron, but he is still very healthy to stick around. Has to be cautious, though. Doesn't have the ghost or the flash available.
It's such a weird scenario for Jin Air, because if they just continue to play calculated, the gold lead becomes more and more irrelevant, and they may just lose a fight straight up. Do they take a 50-50 Baron? Sure, they can DPS it down quickly, but if they lose the Baron, they also probably lose. So how they problem solve here, it's a tricky one, Achilleos.
Yeah. Both these teams have struggled immensely when it comes to closing out games, and Jin Air is still showing that hesitation, wanting to play things very safely. Starting to rotate back over towards this Baron, likely to clear out some wards. The Hawkshot comes through, so they do identify that it's not being taken yet. Cougar just desperately trying to keep a hold of that control ward. And looks like the tanks will just go ahead and return down to the bottom lane, so on. Going to try to keep up that pressure. Both he and the Poppy have TPs up, so they could join at a moment's notice.
This is about as good a vision line as Jin Air has been able to create, so that's why they've started the Baron here, as we can tell.
Yep, MZ going in on the back side of the pit. Edge, he uses the Realm Warp to come down on top of Soan to try to take him out, but you can see he's got plenty of damage to trade back. We'll try to sprint his way out of here. Pops the Flash. Baron now down below half HP. Punch waiting in the wings, looking for a smite opportunity. Soul gets chunked up with a Mega Inferno Bomb. Baron down below 3K. Snowflower goes low, pops out the Stranglethorns, will not catch the Rek'Sai.
Oh boy!
They're trying to delay, that's going to be the Nethergrass coming through. The Baron is picked up by Teddy with the last hit, but now Kuzan gets jumped on. Ash Arrow from Soul, not going to connect. They are able to take out the Malzahar. So far, two members of Jin Air dead. Edge not able to pinch in time to really lock down any of these three remaining members of Jin Air. But now Kongdu, they're going to try to counter push in onto these turrets. They'll at least come up with a tier one. Can they get more? Punch and Guger both very low.
And no frontline means that they were able to take the first turret. Snowfire's backing. I don't know if it was quite envisioned. They're trying to brute force this, but so much damage from the Ziggs.
Big shield comes out, though, from Guger using the Mantra to try to empower that, but you can see they still just aren't able to do it now with these Baron-empowered minions arriving. They will go ahead and have to kite back, and now it's time for concern, truly for Kongdu Monster, as the Elder is going to be spawning in 25 seconds, and Jin Air have the Baron.
Yeah, they have the Baron, as you say. They will also get in position very soon. Big investment here from Kongdu. It meant that there would never be a true fight around Baron. So eventually, very slowly, taking down Soan, who flashed away. We'll see how many summons had to be used. That was one first from the Poppy. Let's see if Kongdu, if Edge also had to use summoners. He did not, so that's at least something. Didn't have flash up anyway.
And here we go.
Edge is only now backing, so this should be pretty free for the side of Jin Air.
Yep, I mean, he does have a Realm Warp, but you can see they're just shredding through this Elder Dragon at the moment. Punch wrapping around from the back, does have the GA. You have to think he's going to have to go for the Hail Mary play. Gets another grass immediately. Elder Dragon not quite low enough. They're going to go ahead and peel off. Soan will be tanking this up as they just try to kill off this Rek'Sai in the back lines. Gets kicked away. Sonic Wave comes through. Teddy comes up with the killing blow. Kongdu Monster, can they find the Miracle Seal? They eject Umte. Can they get it? They do. That's going to be Edge coming up with a pickup. Realm Warp comes down. They're all going to exit together. Massive pickup for Kongdu Monster that might just keep their dreams alive.
Look at Roach. Actually made a massive play. As you say, ejecting out the Lee Sin. There would have been no smite contest. Lee Sin used a smite, but not enough to take it down. And they're trying to fast rotate into mid. They realize they gaffed. It was a big mistake, but they want to answer here and force something.
Soul goes low. That bouncing bomb certainly would have killed him, and now the turret just absolutely being shredded down by Jin Air. This should be the inhibitor going over to them, just unable to defend it. Zol still being chased on by Kuzan. Doesn't want to flash in to try to go for the
it's
steal.
Dead.
But yeah, that's actually going to be Teddy going down edge, able to come up with the kill. Looks like he flashed in, got the root, and was able to burst him
they
with a combo.
More.
Luger's coming in, flashes the wall. The tether comes down, but Snowflower will flash in response and take him out to safety. Now Kuzan going over the wall, still has his flash available, but Punch has arrived. Umbro won't connect. They're still trying to kill him. Meanwhile, Zol duking it out with Snowflower, comes up with the kill, won't go down, and that is four kills picked up for Kongdu Monster on Jhin Air.
This game exploded to life, first with the really nice steal from Kongdu Monster onto the Drake, and then Jhin Air realized, okay, when this Baron buff wears out, we can't teamfight against this enemy team. We need all the objectives now, because we may never get a better time. But the big story was specifically Edge and the AoE taking down Ziggs with Ziggs dead. Everyone runs in different directions. The siege comp from Jhin Air, no way for them to step up. And now against the run of play, Kongdu might have been able to weather the storm, because with these death timers being so long, they're actually finally getting a lot of the standing gold they were unable to get earlier in the game.
I mean, the tier one going down, they get the tier two in mid just about there, yeah.
It's 1,500 gold, Achilleos, and this red side team outscales Jhin Air hardcore.
Kongdu Monster have to position perfectly from here on out so that they don't get popped. There is an innate summoner spell advantage right now on the side of Jhin Air for the key carries. Edge and Zol both without their flashes. Teddy has both of his summoners available. So if he finds Zol, gets that Mega Inferno Mob down, that should be the Ash falling.
I think quite simply, Jhin Air can't five-man group around either top lane or bot lane. They need to play the map. They need Jace to be the ultimate equalizer for Kongdu, because Kongdu is just going to use the ultimate here from the Ryze, Realm Warp into the backline, and then Poppy and Rek'Sai will wreck the backline alongside the Ryze, who is now getting to basically unkillable status. If they can play the map specifically, Jace in the bot lane, the other four in the top lane, and avoid a hard engage, they have a chance. But the setups here are so difficult that Jhin Air will have to be precise, otherwise Brute Force Kongdu Monster have enough ways to initiate to force another fight and win the game.
I mean, I gotta say, the way that Kongdu is playing this latter half of the game, even if they lose, I am very excited to see Game 3, because this has turned into quite the competitive series, even for the bottom two squads right now, or well, tied for 8th place currently is Jhin Air.
Well, the excitement is it's not a fiesta. This is not poor play. Kongdu played a very ordered Game 1, took that down in good fashion. Jhin Air were ahead, but ahead with a poke comp is always such a slippery slope. And the game has started to swing slowly back to Kongdu. But certainly not decided just yet.
See, Zol still very susceptible to those shock blasts. Mega Inferno Bomb does come out, blindly thrown by Teddy, so won't hit onto Zol and chunk out the Ash even further. He's got that Mercurial Scimitar, so he's got enough lifesteal to go ahead, just soak up the waves in the top lane, keep himself healthy.
1,300 gold now, the difference between the two teams. You asked me which team is stronger, Double Infernal, 1,000 gold odd lead Jhin Air or Kongdu. I'd still say Kongdu, specifically with the scalings. But the gold lead doesn't really count for much.
Ash Arrow fishing for it. Ash Arrow comes through onto Snowflower. He'll be all right as Roach goes very far forward, taking a lot of damage in the exchange. The grass comes down, but that's going to be a very big redemption to pop him back up around half HP. Has a Guardian Angel still to rely on. So can play recklessly like that, but they get a lot of summoner spells forward. Kuzan popping the ghost, popping the flash. So-ons as well.
How do Malzahar and Jace position now with no summoners? Very difficult for that duo to get much done in the next 4 to 5 minutes. That gives Kongdu control over the map for perhaps the first time all game. And finally, they can put down Vision. Suddenly the tunnel network is on the Jhin Air side of things. They can push up Vision. They haven't been able to stick Vision more optimistically or more aggressively than their own Raptors for 40 minutes. Suddenly the map is free here for Kongdu. Double Guardian Angel available. 6-item Ryze, including a Luden's Echo, interestingly. The reason here is that, you know, Malzahar's not going to build any magic resist. Sure, there's QSS onto Snowflower, but no more than that. Everyone is squishy on the side of Jhin Air. Why not go for the earlier game spike, the extra movement speed, acquire a target, and one round of spells will easily delete basically anyone on the side of Jhin Air, if you're right.
Baron has respawned. Rise of control coming through from both sides.
374 move speed now without Any other items?
Quite a bit. You can see they want to go for a TP play here. Roach has a couple different options that he could approach with this. Going to go ahead, pop this one right in front of Jhin Air as they start up the Baron. It's down to half HP already. Pitching in from the side. Keeper's already comes through. Clear target onto Oop. They actually just going to go ahead and turn stuns him into the wall. He flashes over, has that Guardian Angel still keeping him alive and in the fight. Got an ejection onto Teddy, but not the most relevant. He's got so much long-range power. Realm Warp coming through. They're going to go right in on top of Jhin Air yet again. Fangledorns comes through, pops up Roach, pops up Punch, but they're jumping straight in onto Kuzan, and he's going to go down. They answer a kill with Guger. Dragon's Rage comes through. Big kick as Edge goes
fight.
Down. That's going to be a massive opening for Jhin Air as they flash forward. Soul desperately trying to kite back, but he just can't do it. A double kill, a triple kill will be picked up by Oomty as the Sonic Wave connects in onto the face of Soul. Now Roach all on his lonesome. GA the only thing keeping him alive. He will go down, and you have to think that is going to be the game. The death timers are just so long, they can burst down this inhib, and Jhin Air, they're going to keep this series going. They're going to take us to game three.
One setup mistake from Kongu is what really cost them. They were too quick on the teleport from Roach, and they turned in a position where they weren't really going to get much value. Once they channeled up that ultimate from Roach, he was the hero around Elder Dragon. Bit of a villain around Baron, you'd have to say. No pressure onto Teddy, no pressure onto the damage. It means that Jhin Air turned the fight, turned the game they had the lead for so long. Looked like perhaps it was going to get away from them. It doesn't. They stick the landing, do the Jhin Air Green Wings. And now we're on to game three in what has been a very competitive series.
Really back and forth there. Kongdu Monster almost able to bring out the 2-0. For their first match win, but now Jhin Air able to fight back. They collected themselves by the end of that game, and they come out on top, and they will force us into a game three. Kongdu Monster go back over to the blue side, which does increase their chances of getting Graves for Punch.
As you say, let's see if the blue side does take the victory. It's been the higher win rate around the world. It's gone blue side so far this series. Kongdu was so close. It looked like, in my estimation, they would win this game, but dramatic misfire on a single fight. Carries go down. No way for them to turn the fight. Good stuff from Jhin Air, but could have been a different result for Kongdu. They'll certainly be kicking themselves if they can't pick up the win in the last one, because this was their series to finally get one on the board.
Yeah, 2-0 victory would have been so much for these guys to try to start clawing their way back up the rankings to get prepped for round two, but for now, that will be evading them. Have to look for this game three as they move back over to the blue side. Jhin Air looked out of sorts when we saw them in game one, so let's see if Kongdu can replicate their performance. We're going to go to a quick break. When we come back, we will have this third and final game between Kongdu and Jhin Air. We'll see who will be the victor, because both of these teams desperately needing a win.
Yeah, specifically Kongdu coming into IEM very soon, needing every bit of confidence they can get. A lot of good things to take from the first two games, but not a 2-0 like you said. And who knows what's going to happen in the last match.
Yep, MT looking much better on that Lee Sin, so certainly something that he could bring out on the red side here in game three. This one's for all the marbles. Both sides desperately wanting that win. Jhin Air need to get themselves out of that eighth place spot, move up to seventh. So we'll go ahead, get ready to jump into that break, and then when we come back, we will have that third and final game, so don't go anywhere, guys. It's been a bit of an explosive series, not one that we necessarily predicted, but explosive all the same. We'll be back in just a few.